you should know that the evidence you are about to hear has never been refuted. Not one time. Not by George Smith, not by Matt Delahunty, not by Dan Barker, not by anyone. It is relatively simple. It is relatively quick. It consists of 8 premises and 1 conclusion. And that conclusion will clearly prove that there is a God. And the attributes of that God that is proven to exist are all clearly listed in the scriptures as the attributes of the God of the Bible. And those attributes are eternal, transcendent, the source of all creation, the source of all power, and intelligent. Though most of you, if not all of you who are familiar with the scripture, already know that these attributes belong to the God of the Bible, let me give you some clear and unmistakable proof of this. And to do so, I'm going to make use of my book, The Fight, since it already has multiple verses organized relating to each of these attributes. And you can see these on page 62 and 63 in The Fight. Beginning with the first 2 attributes, eternal and transcendent, I'm going to use one verse that relates to both of these, that confirms both of these attributes as belonging to the God of the Bible. It's Psalm chapter 90, verse 2, and you see it here. And it reads, "Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, you were God." The next attribute, the source of all creation, Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, and Isaiah chapter 42, verse 5, and that's found on page 63. Down here under God is the creator of the heavens and the earth. Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Isaiah chapter 42, verse 5, "Thus says God the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread forth the earth and that which comes from it, who gives breath to the people on it and spirit to those who walk on it." The next attribute, the source of all power, and we're looking here under God is omnipotent, Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 17. "Ah, Lord God, behold, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and outstretched arm. There is nothing too hard for you." And the final attribute, intelligence. Job chapter 37, verse 16, and Psalm chapter 147, verse 5. And those are under God as omniscient here. Job chapter 37, verse 16. "Do you know how the clouds are balanced, those wondrous works of him who is perfect in knowledge?" Psalm chapter 147, verse 5. "Great is our Lord, mighty in power. His understanding is infinite." Now, the Bible proclaimed all of these necessary attributes as belonging to the God of the Bible thousands of years before modern science would come to the conclusion that whatever is eternal absolutely must also contain, at the very minimum, these 4 additional attributes. Therefore, whatever is eternal must also be transcendent, the source of all creation, the source of all power, and intelligent. But for now, we're going to set this conclusion aside and revisit it afterward to determine if we are forced to accept this conclusion if we intend to follow the evidence. Now to the evidence and the premises that the evidence confirms. Beginning with premise 1, existence does not come from non-existence. Ask yourself this question. Is it possible for a married bachelor to be the cause of something beginning to exist? For example, you work as a professor at a local university, and one day you walk into the classroom only to see that one of your very important notebooks is on the floor and it's on fire. You ask the students, "Who started this fire?" They all respond by telling you that a married bachelor came running into the room, set the notebook on fire, and then took off. Of course, you're immediately 100% certain that whatever the cause was for your notebook going up in flames, the cause was certainly not a married bachelor. Why? Because a married bachelor cannot exist. By definition, it is a logical impossibility. Therefore, since it cannot exist, it does not exist. And because it does not exist, it cannot be the cause of something beginning to exist. Proving premise 1, that existence does not come from non-existence. Premise 2, something exists. For you to argue against this premise is for you to prove the premise. After all, if you did not exist, you could not argue against the premise. Therefore, proving premise 2, that something exists. Premise 3, Something is eternal, meaning something exists though it had no beginning. This follows logically from premise one and premise two. After all, if existence does not come from non-existence, and something exists, then something must necessarily be eternal. Otherwise, existence came from non-existence, which, again, premise one already proved is absurd, thus establishing premise three, something is eternal. Yet, keep in mind that at this stage of the argument, I have only proven that something is eternal. But what that something is has not yet been uncovered. But at this point, it is fair for us to at least begin thinking about the question, what could be eternal? It could be a God. It could be our universe. It could be the multiverse, also referred to by many as the cosmos. So again, at this point, I have not yet proven what is eternal. I have simply proven premise three, that something is eternal. Okay, I hope you guys are having fun. We're already up to premise four, and it is. The universe is not eternal. I suppose even before I present any proof for this, I should first point out that this premise is now, by and large, agreed upon by both theists and non-theists of all types. Remember Lawrence Krauss, the gentleman whom I pointed out had written the foreword on George Smith's book, Atheism, The Case Against God? I told you that you would hear more from him later in my discussion. Well, Lawrence Krauss is not only an incredibly vocal and outspoken atheist, but he is also one of the most famous theoretical physicists and cosmologists on the planet. He has taught at Arizona State University, Yale University, and Case Western Reserve University. He is the founder of the Origins Project, now called the ASU Interplanetary Initiative, formed to investigate fundamental questions about the universe. He has also participated in a number of very popular debates on the existence of God. In his debate against a Muslim, he clearly goes on record in support of this premise, stating that our visible universe is not eternal.
That the beginning of the universe is very important. You deduced it, but in fact, deduction doesn't matter. The point is, the universe, our visible universe, did have a beginning because we can measure it. Whether we liked it or not, or whether we think it's sensible or not, it actually did have a beginning, a cause, not a factor not in dispute. Our universe had a beginning.
So again, as you just heard, and as I stated already, this premise is now, by and large, agreed upon by both theists and non-theists of all types. Of course, Christians have always believed this. After all, as I showed earlier, it is the clear testimony of the scriptures. Yet, the scientific community held tightly to its belief in an eternal universe until it was forced to come kicking and screaming over to the Christian side of the debate. And the force that compelled them to that position was a mountain of evidence so large that it became completely untenable to continue to claim that the universe was eternal. I think it is clear that one of the reasons that so many held so tightly to the belief in an eternal universe is that if it was proven that the universe was not eternal, then there had to be a cause for its creation. And that cause, as we are finding out, would look a lot like the God of the Bible. But if the universe was eternal, there's no need to look for a creator. But as science advanced, evidence like the expansion of the universe, the radiation echo, and the laws of thermodynamics, this evidence and much more forced the scientific community to become creationists. After all, if the universe is not eternal, something else had to be, because premise one has already proven that existence does not come from non-existence. So now, the scientific and atheistic community faced a huge dilemma. They were forced to find a creator, and having rejected even the thought that it could be the God of the Bible, they went on a pursuit to find another candidate. But again, both sides of the argument agree with premise four. The universe is not eternal. Premise 5. Whatever is eternal transcends the universe. Now this follows logically from premises 3 and 4. After all, if something is eternal, regardless of what it is, if it is the God of the Bible, or if it is the multiverse, or anything else, if it is eternal, it transcends our space-time universe. Once again, in another debate on the existence of God, Lawrence Krauss goes on record stating that his candidate for the eternal and transcendent source from which our universe sprang, namely the multiverse, he says it has some of the same attributes as the God of the Bible. It is eternal, transcendent, and the origin from which our universe came into existence. Let's listen to Lawrence preach about his eternal, transcendent creator.
my opponents might argue that the multiverse, which our universe might have spontaneously been created in, was created by physicists because they don't like God, because it's eternal and exists outside our universe, the same characteristics that God is supposed to have. But it wasn't created because we don't like God, although I don't like God.
Did you get that? Lawrence is concerned that his opponents might argue that the multiverse was created because physicists don't like God. Because, after all, similar to the God of the Bible, the multiverse, out of which Lawrence states that our universe might have spontaneously been created, that multiverse is also eternal and exists outside our universe, i.e., it is transcendent. Then he points out that these are the, quote, same characteristics that the God of the Bible is supposed to have, unquote. Then he goes on to say that the multiverse theory wasn't created because we don't like God, but he don't like God. Let me remind you. Premise 5 states that whatever is eternal transcends the universe. And it is important for you to see that Dr. Krauss vehemently argues that physicists claim that the multiverse has at least some of the very same attributes as the God of the Bible. They have concluded that if the multiverse exists, it is eternal, transcendent, and the source from which our universe was created, which perfectly leads to my next premise. Moving down to premise 6. Whatever is eternal is the source of all creation. Proof of this? The initial source of anything brought into existence must ultimately be traced back to what is eternal. Otherwise, existence would have come from non-existence, which has already been proven to be absurd. Proving premise 6, that whatever is eternal is the source of all creation. So, keep it in mind that we have not yet concluded what is eternal, but only that something is. Yet, if something is eternal, and again, I've proven that something is, but regardless of what that something is, whether it be the multiverse or God, or as some have mockingly suggested, the giant spaghetti monster, some might ask, what caused that thing to exist? Such a question demonstrates a complete ignorance of what it means to be eternal. After all, if anything is truly eternal, be it the multiverse, our visible universe, the God of the Bible, or the giant spaghetti monster, it would be absurd to ask what caused it. It would be like pointing to a circle and asking why it is not a square. A circle is not a square by definition alone. A circle is a shape consisting of all points in a plane that are at a given distance from a given point, the center. Whereas a square is defined as a plane figure with four equal straight sides and four right angles. So by definition alone, it is absurd to ask, why can't a circle be a square? Likewise, to ask of something that is eternal, i.e. something that exists yet it had no beginning, to ask what caused it to exist is like asking why a circle is not a square. The definition of the very words being used reveal the absurdity of the question. To ask what caused something to exist when something is eternal is to misunderstand the definition of what it means to be eternal. If anything is eternal and without beginning, it has no cause, regardless of what it is. Premise 7. Whatever is eternal is the source of all power. Proof of this. The initial source of all the power that exists must ultimately be traced back to what is eternal. Otherwise, existence, power in this case, would have come from non-existence, which has already been proven to be absurd. Therefore, proving premise 7. Whatever is eternal is the source of all power. Now we consider our final premise, premise 8. Whatever is eternal is intelligent. Science is based upon experimentation and observation. So whenever we encounter the effect of a cause we did not see, for example, coming home and finding a window with a tiny round hole in it, we will automatically play the forensic scientist. And using what is commonly referred to as the principle of uniformity, which principle is the foundation of science, after all, it is entirely based upon observation and experimentation, and or experimentation and observation, depending upon the circumstances. For a further discussion on this, you can see the link that's below in the description of the video. But what this principle teaches us is that similar effects have similar causes. So, going back to the scenario where you come home and see a small round hole in your living room window, like is pictured here, your mind automatically will begin searching its data banks in an attempt to recall a similar effect, hoping that it can also recall what caused that similar effect. After all, even if you don't have any formal background in science, you practice the principle of uniformity every day of your life, even though you most often practice it subconsciously. And it is this principle that confirms to your mind that similar effects have similar causes. So if you can recall a similar effect, a similar style hole in a glass window, and if you can recall that cause of that similar effect, you may well be able to determine what caused this hole, even though you did not see the event happen. As you may now be thinking to yourself, this principle of uniformity is the very principle that is the foundation of forensic science. The reason a forensic scientist can tell that a man was shot while standing up, as opposed to laying on the bed, is that through experimentation and observation, they are able to determine that the only scenario that the blood spatter could occur the way that it did is if the man was standing up. Now, as we go back to our window with a hole in it, you happen to recall that in the past, you have seen two or three similar holes like this in other windows, and each time it was caused by a BB gun or a pellet gun being shot through the window. So you go inside your home, you look around, and there on the floor, directly across the room from the window, you find a BB. You don't have a BB gun, and you have lived in that house ever since you had it built 10 years ago. However, you continue to look around the room, then you go outside and look through the hole, noticing that it went all the way through the glass, and noticing that you don't see any glass on the outside, but you do see bits of glass on the inside of the house, indicating that whatever broke the glass came from the outside. Again, on the assumption based upon the principle of uniformity. Yet, after you finish diligently searching for anything else that might have been the cause, you find nothing. What do you think are the chances that the hole was caused by the BB? Even though you did not see the event occur, past experiences and the principle of uniformity make it nearly impossible for you to think of another reasonable cause for the hole in the window. So how can the principle of uniformity help us in our task of determining if life is the product of an intelligent designer? Well, to begin with, I think that we can all agree that none of us have ever seen life spontaneously arise from non-life. Yet all of us have seen countless examples of people using their intelligence to originate the creation of machines that work together using highly coordinated moving parts. How do these two declarations relate to the issue we're discussing, you ask? The answer will become abundantly clear and of infinite significance after I introduce you to Ken Dill and Bruce Alberts, because what both of these men will make irrefutably clear is that life in any form, and even viruses, which some scientists call life and others do not, but either way, whether they are considered life or not, does not affect the fact that there is a 100% consensus that living cells and viruses both consist of molecular machines. And without these molecular machines, neither life or viruses could ever exist. No machines, no life. No machines, no viruses. Let's meet Ken Dill now. Ken Dill is a biophysicist who is a member of the U.S. National Academy of Sciences and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. He is also the director of the Center for Physical and Quantitative Biology at Stony Brook University. Ken is a top authority on protein machines. Ken has a YouTube video where he discusses protein machines. Let's hear Ken state what is the purpose of this talk that he is giving.
And the case I want to make for you is that proteins are machines. You have 20,000 odd different types of machines in your body, and then other kinds of living organisms have other kinds of protein machines. There's tens of thousands to hundreds of thousands of different machines. And the first case I want to make for you is that these are real machines. That's not a metaphor. They use energy, they spin around, they pump, they act to cause force and motion.
I want to quickly reiterate five of the significant points that Ken made. Point number one, he said, the case that I want to make for you is that proteins are machines. Point number two, you have 20,000 different types of machines in your body. Point number three, other kinds of living organisms have other kinds of protein machines. Point number four, there are tens of thousands to hundreds of thousands of different machines. And finally, point number five, he said, the case I want to make for you is that these are real machines. That is not a metaphor. Okay, now, let's get back to Ken a little further along in this discussion. You can view the entire video by clicking the link below. After Ken's final clip, I have a few additional clips to help you understand even more clearly the facts that Ken has elucidated in his discussion.
I've just shown you a few examples of tens of thousands of protein machines, but the case I want to make for you is just to convince you they are real machines, just at the super microscopic level. There's a half a trillion big world machines out there in the world right now. You have more machines in the tip of your little finger than there are total big world machines out there.
Deep inside your mitochondria, rows of molecular motors generate ATP, the molecule essential to all life on Earth. Enzymes bring together reactants to form a chemical bond, converting mechanical energy into chemical energy. A ring of enzymes work in step, creating three molecules of ATP with each cycle. Inside the molecular motor, a rotating axle powers the sequence. The axle is attached to a rotary molecular motor, moved by the force of protons pushing from the other side of the membrane. A difference in proton concentration propels the molecular mechanism. Synthesis of ATP. ATP drives biochemical activity inside your living cells and is a key building block of DNA and RNA.
Using computer animation based on molecular research, we are now able to see how DNA is actually copied in living cells. You are looking at an assembly line of amazing miniature biochemical machines that are pulling apart the DNA double helix and cranking out a copy of each strand. The DNA to be copied enters the production line from bottom left. The whirling blue molecular machine is called helicase. It spins the DNA as fast as a jet engine as it unwinds the double helix into two strands. One strand is copied continuously and can be seen spooling off to the right. Things are not so simple for the other strand because it must be copied backwards. It is drawn out repeatedly in loops and copied one section at a time. The end result is two new DNA molecules.
between the microtubules and the chromosome. The kinetochore is one of the largest and most complex molecular mechanisms inside living cells, with multiple functions to perform. The kinetochore is central to the movement of the chromosomes and is able to hang on to the dynamic ends of the microtubules. It is also a mechanical tension sensing system, which is able to feel if everything is correctly attached and positioned. It is also a stop signal broadcasting system, sending out chemical signals to the rest of the cell about whether it is ready to undergo separation of the chromosomes. This kinetochore has sensed that the tension is just right and the chromosome is correctly positioned and attached. The last little bit remaining red is the stop signal broadcasting system. It is carried away by a dynein motor, walking down the microtubule away from the kinetochore. These are molecular motors involved with a directed transport along the mitotic spindle. The orange proteins walking to the left are kinesins, molecular motors carrying proteins on their back. Striding from the kinetochore on long molecular legs are dynein, carrying the stop signal broadcasting system.
Let me summarize all of what you have just seen by reading to you the words of the former president of the National Academy of Sciences, Bruce Alberts, as he echoes what Ken Dill has just said, as well as what you have just seen, when he writes in the following article on Cell.com. The title of the article is "The Cell as a Collection of Protein Machines, Preparing the Next Generation of Molecular Biologists." This is what he writes. "We have always underestimated cells. Undoubtedly, we still do today. But at least we are no longer as naive as we were when I was a graduate student in the 1960s. Then, most of us viewed cells as containing a giant set of second-order reactions." He goes on to say, "But as it turns out, we can walk and we can talk, because the chemistry that makes life possible is much more elaborate and sophisticated than anything we students had ever considered. Proteins make up most of the dry mass of a cell, but instead of a cell dominated by randomly colliding individual protein molecules, we now know that nearly every major process in a cell is carried out by assemblies of 10 or more protein molecules. And as it carries out its biological functions, each of these protein assemblies interacts with several other large complexes of proteins." This is key. "Indeed, the entire cell can be viewed as a factory that contains an elaborate network of interlocking assembly lines, each of which is composed of a set of large protein machines." He continues, "Why do we call the large protein assemblies that underlie cell function protein machines? Precisely because, like the machines invented by humans to deal efficiently with a macroscopic world, these protein assemblies contain highly coordinated moving parts." Hearing these facts and seeing them demonstrated in video after video, we can be certain that whatever is eternal is intelligent, and we can be certain and without question as to that fact. Why, you ask? Because through experimentation and observation of hundreds and hundreds of billions of examples, all of the big world machines, we have discovered only one cause that is capable of originating the specified complexity needed to build machines with highly coordinated moving parts. And that one cause is intelligence. And we do not have one counterexample that challenges this claim. As Ken Dill said, we have a half trillion big world machines, such things as cars, airplanes, boats, motorcycles, televisions, refrigerators, air conditioning units, cell phones, etc. If you trace the line of any one of those half trillion or 500 billion big world machines back to its origin, 100% of the time, without one exception, you find the input of intelligence to be a necessary part of the process, confirming that intelligence is both a sufficient and necessary cause in that process. Therefore, until someone can show another sufficient cause that is proven to be so, and not simply a pipe dream being clung to by those who refuse to follow the science, but solid conclusions clearly demonstrated through the scientific method of observation experimentation, until such a time comes to pass, we are not only entirely justified to claim that the initial source and cause of the 500 billion little world machines that are in the tip of your little pinky, that they must include intelligence. We are obligated to demand this conclusion. So let me make it very clear to those who reject this premise. We have, for all practical purposes, an unlimited number of examples proving that intelligence is a capable and sufficient cause to originate the specified complexity needed to build machines with highly coordinated moving parts. Yet, I am arguing more than that. I am arguing that the only cause we know that is both sufficient and necessary in originating the specified complexity needed to build machines with highly coordinated moving parts is intelligence. I have a proven cause that is demonstrated sufficient for the task, and it has been proven so hundreds of billions of times. The atheist proposes pie-in-the-sky theories, yet never one time demonstrates through observation and experimentation that his theory has originated a machine without intelligence being introduced somewhere in the process. Not once has he proven that. But someone always proposes the objection, well, Eric, we have tons of examples of these molecular machines beginning to exist without intelligence being involved. After all, trees produce trees. Through years of evolution, there is no intelligence involved, therefore proving that your argument is incorrect, Eric. This was actually an argument that Matt Dillahunty used in a debate with me. However, the utter failure and foolishness of this argument is easily demonstrated by the following comparison. Imagine somebody's trying to argue that just like we have trees that make trees and viruses that make viruses, we now also have computers that are completely capable of making computers. Therefore, intelligence is not needed to make a computer. Do you see the point? After all, in biology, we have trillions and trillions of examples of machines making machines without introducing new intelligence into the process. You ask, well, doesn't that just disprove your entire argument, Eric? Not in the slightest. Why? Because just like we can build computers that can afterward build new and additional computers without adding intelligence, in exactly the same way, living things and viruses can produce additional protein molecular machines because the information needed to do so is already present. So in like comparison to the computers, we are looking at examples that already had the intelligence present that was needed to build the machines in the first place. I am not, nor have I ever argued, that machines cannot build machines. And remember, protein molecular machines are real machines. But if you can trace the line back far enough, meaning to the first introduction of machines with highly coordinated moving parts, 100% of the time, without one exception, you find that the input of intelligence is a necessary part of the process of originating the specified complexity needed to build machines with highly coordinated moving parts. Confirming that intelligence is both a sufficient and necessary cause in that process. Therefore, until someone can show another sufficient cause, we are not only entirely justified to claim that the initial source and or cause of countless little world machines must include intelligence, we are obligated to demand this conclusion, therefore proving premise 8, that whatever is eternal is intelligent. Summarizing our premises, we can conclude. Premise 1, existence does not come from non-existence. Premise 2, something exists. Premise 3, something is eternal, meaning something exists, though it had no beginning. Premise 4, the universe is not eternal. Premise 5, whatever is eternal transcends the universe. Premise 6, whatever is eternal is the source of all creation. Premise 7, whatever is eternal is the source of all power. And premise 8, whatever is eternal is intelligent. Putting all the findings from these premises together, we can be certain that something exists which is eternal, transcendent, the source of all creation and power that is also intelligent. There is a God.
Atheism has never created an artistic masterpiece, never healed a fatal disease or calmed the fear. Atheism has never still given answers to our existence, peace to a troubled mind, or even dried a tear. For it's God created heaven and earth and flung the stars in space and breathed in a handful of dirt and became a man. It's God who sits on the circle of the earth and measures the mountains in a scale and holds the seven seas in the palm of his hand. It's God who sent his only begotten Son to the cross of Calvary to save our souls from hell and the grave. It's God who creates, God who delivers, God who heals, and God who is worthy of a thunderous ovation of praise. There is a hope.
In closing, let me say to those of you who, at the beginning of the video, you were wondering whether or not it really was possible to prove the existence of God. Now you have your proof, and I want you to know that what you will find out is the God that I prove to exist is indeed the God of the Bible. He is eternal, transcendent, the source of all creation, supremely powerful and intelligent, and that is the God who sent his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, into the world so that you might be forgiven of your sin and have eternal life. And I want you to know in the same way that I gave evidence that it's the God of the Bible that exists, by his grace, sometime in the very near future, I will also give rock solid evidence that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and he is the Savior of the world. So before I leave, I want to sincerely thank all of you for watching the video. I hope that you'll please consider subscribing. And I hope to get a lot of likes from my atheist friends. And please ring the bell so that you'll be notified of future videos being posted. God bless you. Have an awesome day.